Okie-do. Welcome today at our 25th Workplace NIA User Group Tuesday's webinar. Today we have Jan Bakker, and he's going to tell us everything about Azure Multi-Factor Authentication. But first, before I hand it over to Jan, let's first thank our sponsors. As we always say, without any sponsors, we're not able to organize events like this. And hopefully after the summer, back to on-premises events again. But let's see how the vaccination goes and how the rules will be in the September, October, November timeframe. But thanks again for our sponsors. If you want to follow us, join us, follow those handles, Twitter handles, Meetup URLs, Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn, and use the hashtag WPNIASNL if you want to reach out to us. We have some upcoming events scheduled. The next Workplace NIA User Group Tech Tuesdays is June the 8th with Thorsten and Michael, and they are going to tell us everything about Teams phone systems, a must-have for the more modern workplace. 2 weeks after that, I will be finally on the list and tell you a couple of practical tips to secure your corporate data with Microsoft 365. And June 29, we have a live Ask Me Anything again with Ronnie and Franz. And I believe this will also be Teams related. If you want to speak on a webinar like this, or maybe in the future when we have we are back on premises, go to Sessionize and submit your session. And if you want, you need help submitting your session or help presenting, feel free to reach out. We are happy to help you making the steps towards presenting a session. And yeah, let's hand it over to Jan. Jan, thanks for joining us, and good luck with your session.
Thanks, folks. Let's share my screen. There we go. Are you able to see my screen?
Yeah, perfect.
Perfect. Okay, thanks. So first of all, thanks for giving this opportunity to speak at this awesome user group. Today we're going to talk about Azure MFA. But first, let's introduce myself. I'm a modern workplace consultant focusing on identity and access and the modern workplace, like Intune, Azure Active Directory. I'm from the Netherlands. So this is a home game for me. I have a own blog, janbakker.tech, where I put out my ramblings that you can read. You can find me on Twitter as well. I'm recently awarded as a Microsoft MVP, which I'm really honored to be. And if I have time left, I'm also a guitarist. I like drinking beer, spending time with my family. And I do sports once in a while, but I should do it more often. I say that in every session, but let's take it from here. What are we going to do today? Well, first we're going to look, why do we need MFA? Because before we can enable MFA, we need to know why we need to do MFA. Next, we're going to talk about the maze of settings and portals that are out there that can affect those settings in Azure MFA. And next to that, I'm going to show you what different ways there are to enable MFA, because as the saying says, all roads lead to Rome. There are different ways to enable Azure MFA. And last but not least, we're going to take some time to dive into the Graph API to do some automation and provisioning for Azure MFA. So the key takeaways for today, you're going to learn the different ways to enable MFA. You're going to understand the Graph API possibilities for using with together with authentication methods. All the different settings out there, I'm going to take you through all the settings and the portals. And I try to share some tips and tricks from the field, so what I've learned in the past, especially around COVID and working from home. So why do we need MFA? Stay tuned. I made it really easy for you. I got this this cheat sheet and that you can follow. So to start off, if your password is 123456, you better turn on MFA. And if your password contains the name of your cat, or maybe you spelled it backwards, or you threw in some fancy characters, also turn on MFA. If your password contains special characters like the one I've showed here, passwords, also turn on MFA. Even if your password is 64 characters long, you should turn on MFA. Or I don't know if it's possible, but if your password contains a blood sample of a Chinese desert mouse, you should even then turn on MFA, because your password doesn't matter. No matter how strong your password is, you always need to enable MFA, because your password can be stolen and then your password doesn't matter anymore. To make it even more clear, I made a diagram, and it shows all the reasons that you should why you should enable MFA. And that pretty much says that you should enable MFA because your password doesn't matter. So with that out of the way, let's dive into how to enable Azure MFA, because basically there are three ways to enable Azure MFA within Microsoft 365. The first one, but the far left, is by enabling security defaults. That one is free, but also needs some considerations. I come back to that later. The second one is what we all know is per user MFA. That comes with all Microsoft 365 plans, but you shouldn't use that anymore. I explain why in a minute. And the third one is by using conditional access. And in my opinion, and also Microsoft, this is the way to go. But it does require Azure AD Premium P1 or P2. So let's go by all these methods one by one. Let's start off with security defaults. What is security defaults? Well, security defaults is a really great option that you can turn off and on to secure your Azure AD tenant. And it comes with every tenant. And the only thing that you have to do is either turn it on or off. So what does it do? It does a couple of things. First of all, it requires all your users to register for Azure MFA multi-factor authentication. And you cannot make any exclusions here. And one important thing to mention here is that you can only use Microsoft Authenticator app in the registration portal. Next, it gives a unified multi-factor authentication registration, and your users are able to postpone the registration for 14 days. After 14 days, the registration is enforced and the users cannot sign in until the registration is complete. And also the users can only use Authenticator app. The next thing is that it requires administrators, most of the administrators, to perform multi-factor authentication every time they sign in. So if, for example, global administrators, SharePoint administrators, Exchange administrators, and so on, the list is out there. Most important, it does block legacy authentication protocols all the way. And here as well, there is no exception to make. What does it mean, blocking legacy authentication? I think you all know. Clients that don't use modern authentication, for example, the older Office versions like 2010, are not able to connect to Microsoft 365, even as the older mail protocols such as IMAP, SMTP, or POP3. The next thing is actually free P2 stuff, because basically you have to pay for this when you use it in combination with conditional access, but within security defaults, this one is free. It requires all your users to perform multi-factor authentication when necessary. So users are prompted on a new device, for example, or when they're performing critical roles and tasks. And again, you cannot make any exclusions here. You also cannot make a break-glass account, and you should use FIDO2 for that instead. The next thing that security defaults does is protecting your privileged activities, like going to the Azure portal or doing something with PowerShell or the CLI or with Azure Resource Manager. Well, what organizations should use security defaults? I think that organizations that want to increase the security posture but don't know where to start should definitely turn on security defaults. It's by far the easiest way to be more secure without going through all the process. It's really easy to turn on. I can show you that in a minute. And of course, organizations that don't have the P1 or P2 licenses, but are on the free tier of Azure Active Directory, should also consider using security defaults. But there are the most of the organizations shouldn't use security defaults. And those are the organizations that are currently using conditional access, because you cannot use conditional access and security defaults together. Also, if you already have Azure Active Directory Premium license, you should not go back to security defaults, because you should use conditional access instead. And if your organization has complex security requirements, you also don't want to use security defaults. As I mentioned before, you cannot use security defaults and conditional access at the same time. You should either disable security defaults and start using conditional access, or don't use conditional access and enable security defaults. So in this demonstration, I will show you how to enable or disable security defaults. So let's switch to my demo environment. Here we are logged in the portal, portal.azure.com. And we are going to Azure Active Directory. Here we got the properties. And from there, you can manage security defaults. And it's really easy. Currently, it's disabled, because if I want to enable it, it says, hey, it looks like you're using custom conditional access policies, which in this case is actually true. So I should leave it off. But this is all. This is how you can enable or disable security defaults in your Azure AD tenant. Well, that's pretty easy, right? Next, per user MFA. And again, I can't stress this enough. Please don't do this only if it's possible, of course, but you rather want to stay away from this. How do you configure per user MFA? It's the most ugliest portal out there. You can go to Microsoft 365 Admin Center and choose multi-factor authentication. Or there is this handy short URL, aka.ms/mfa-portal, which will bring you straight to this portal that might look familiar to you, where you can enable MFA for your users and enforce it. But to be honest, this is the worst experience for your end users, because your users will get prompted every time they sign in to every single application. You cannot make any exclusions. You can make some exclusions by selecting IP addresses that you can exclude, but believe me, it's the worst experience for the end users and also for your administrators, because it's time consuming and unnecessary complex management. You have to enable it or enforce it, and maybe you can use PowerShell scripts for it, or even worse, manual enable per user MFA. It's really complex and time consuming for your administrators. So if you have AD P1 or P2 licenses and you're not using conditional access, you should start migrating today and move away from per user MFA. Let me show you how these per user MFA works. Again, we are going to Azure Active Directory. Scroll back to security, and then we go to MFA. And here you can find additional cloud-based MFA settings, which funny enough is the main panel for Azure MFA, but in this case it's called additional. So when you go to this portal, you will find all the settings for per user MFA. And you could also use the aka.ms/mfa-portal, which basically goes to the same portal. Here, the contrast is not that very clear, but here are two tabs. The one is service settings, which you will land on, which shows all the service settings. And next to that, there is this user tab that you can use to enable MFA per user. And here you can see most of my users are disabled, but for the purpose of this demo, I enabled MFA for Alan, which you can do by selecting this, and here disable or manage the user settings. When we go back to the service settings page, here you can find all the MFA service settings, but this is also applicable for Azure MFA when you use it with conditional access, but we come back to that later. So let's switch back to the slides then. If you're already using MFA per user and you want to switch to conditional access, there's this really awesome script that you can find on the documentation of Microsoft that will let you convert all your per user MFA users to conditional access. So I definitely encourage you to check that out. There are various MFA verification options. To start off, by far the most secure one is Microsoft Authenticator app, but you can also use these hardware tokens, these tokens with the generates OTP tokens. You can use text or SMS, and you can use voice call. And if you're wondering why is this grayed out, this call to phone setting here, it's because of Microsoft. In demo tenants, this one is off because it costs a lot of effort. So when you use call to phone, Microsoft has to pay the bill. So for all the demo tenants, they disable this, but in your paid Azure AD, you can select call to phone to use with Azure MFA. So which of these authentication methods you should use? Well, whenever possible, you should use Microsoft Authenticator app as your default method. It's by far the easiest to use, also for your end user experience. You just have to allow the session instead of typing in a PIN or from your text. But you don't forget to also add a backup method. For example, your phone number. Well, I added here a link to a community blog post about it's time to hang up your phone transports for authentication. Microsoft is really encouraging her users to step away from phone methods for Azure MFA, but I strongly recommend to always have a secure backup method for in case your phone dies or you have to swap another phone. And you can easily swap the SIM card and you are still able to do Azure MFA. And remember, there's a lot of discussion going on about whether text is secure. When you're using Azure MFA with text, it's always better and always safer than using no MFA at all. So you can have discussions about should we enable text or not, but if that is holding back you from enabling MFA, you better start with doing text and then move upwards to, for example, Authenticator app, but don't get stuck in the discussion whether it's safe or not, because it's always safer than to do no MFA at all. Then the third one, conditional access. Yeah, and this is the way to go. I personally think that, but Microsoft also think that, and it's right here in the Azure portal. It says here at the Azure portal, there are many ways of deploying MFA with Azure AD, but the best way is to use Azure MFA in the cloud and to apply it to your users using conditional access. So it's not something that I made up, it's just right there in the portal. So what is conditional access? I don't want to go too deep in detail about conditional access, but you might already be familiar with conditional access, but it's if this, then that statement. But basically you got a lot of signals, a lot of conditions that you can configure, being the user, the location, or the device that you're working on, or the application that you want to go to, or your risk. I come back to that later. And then you can verify this by either allowing blocking access or require MFA before you can access your apps and data within Microsoft 365. So why is conditional access better? It gives you a fine-grained control and more flexibility. So you can make use of named locations, for example, where you can exclude Azure MFA for specific IP ranges or countries, or even today GPS locations. You got plenty of conditions to pick from. You are very flexible with that. And you can also secure the MFA registration by saying, okay, you can only register using a trusted location or a device. I come back to that later. You are also able to exclude trusted devices, for example, devices that you manage with Intune. And you can have break glass admin accounts in case of Azure MFA has failure or outage. You're also able to use conditional access with identity protection. And of course, this requires an Azure AD Premium P2 license, but you can pick up the signals from identity protection and you can use them within conditional access. And with this integration, you are able to do a risk-based MFA and force users to self-remediate their own risk. You can do both sign-in risk and user risk. And there are two things that you can mainly do. You can say, okay, when the sign-in risk is either low, medium, or high, you can require MFA to automate this remediation process for the user, or you can block the session. The same thing is for the user risk, which you can say, okay, when the user risk is high, you want to block the session, or you can pull off a password reset so that the user can remediate themselves. And this also needs to be done together with Azure MFA. So this is a secure password reset method. Again, you need Azure P2 to do this. So let's switch gears here and go back to the demo environment to show you how you enable MFA by using conditional access. So again, we're in the Azure portal. We're going to Azure AD conditional access. And here we can see two policies that they already created. And one of them is your password doesn't matter, enable MFA. So I think that's the one. You can specify users. You can do it for all users, all your guests, or for specific users or groups. You can even exclude users or guests from it. For now, in this demo, I enabled it for Adele. Next, you can specify for what applications do you need MFA. Well, the most secure one is all cloud applications. Then you don't have to worry about new applications are added. They're all enabled with Azure Multi-Factor Authentication. But you can also select apps, and you can also use the include and exclude trick here. The next one is the conditions. If you leave it this way, it will apply MFA for all conditions, but you can use user risk, sign-in risk. You can specify the device platforms, whether it is Windows or macOS or iOS or Android. You also can make differentiation between the client apps, whether it should apply to browsers or also apply to modern desktop apps and clients. And there's also a couple of preview controls that you can use, being the device state. And this one is brand new, filters for devices, where you can go a lot of deeper, but I don't want to go into detail about conditional access. Next, the grant control. You can either grant or block access. And with that, you can require multi-factor authentication, or you can add multiple controls on top of each other. Don't forget to enable the policy before it takes effect. So, in a nutshell, this is how you can enable MFA with conditional access, and you can build multiple policies as well. When we enable MFA, we mainly focusing on identity, but conditional access, as I just show you, is so much more than only just identity protection. So I strongly suggest that you also check out this awesome webinar from a couple of months ago featuring Kenneth van Surksum about conditional access, and you get way more detail and way more to learn about conditional access. I strongly encourage you to watch that episode as well. Oh. So then about the end user experience, because now that we know what the best way is to use Azure MFA, let's focus on the end user experience, because one of the questions I get often is how many times a day is Azure MFA prompting my users? And well, it depends on how you configure Azure MFA, but in the base, when you don't mess around too much with token lifetime and sign-in frequency, and you leave everything by default, it should be one MFA prompt per user, per device, per password change. That's the main rule. And again, it depends on how you configure your tenant, but this is basically what you your users should experience. One MFA prompt per user, per device, per change of your password. So if you switch from device, you should get another MFA prompt. When you change your password recently, with the next sign-in, you can be prompted for MFA. That's the basic rules. There's also a option that you can enable to remember multi-factor authentication on trusted devices. But I recommend that you do not use this, but that you use frequency in conditional access, the sign-in frequency in conditional access instead of this option. So this option can be found in the MFA portal that I showed you earlier. And you can nowadays choose between one or a whole year. But again, you should use conditional access sign-in frequency. For example, to extend session lifetimes on trusted devices or locations or all the different settings that you can do. This is where you can enable this. I can quickly show you that in the live demo tenant. Here you have the session controls, and here's this the sign-in frequency that you can say, okay, I want my users to re-authenticate every 14 days, for example. This is the way to go, as you've seen in this screenshot already. So by default, the rolling window is 90 days. So that means that the user has to re-authenticate after this 19 days. Also, because of the user experience is very important, back in the days when we register for MFA and self-service password reset, we had two portals, one portal for registration for MFA and one portal for self-service password reset. But now this experience is combined. But for older tenants, you need to enable this. For newer tenants, this is already enabled. I believe from August 2020 and forward, all new Azure AD tenants will be automatically enabled for the combined registration. And you cannot use the old legacy portal. But if you have an older tenant, you should enable this combined registration portal manually. And I encourage you, if you are not using this combined registration portal, you should do it first thing tomorrow. So how do you enable this setting? Let's switch back to the tenant. I can show you again. Go back to Azure portal, then to Azure Active Directory. And let's see, under the user settings, there is this user feature preview setting. And here you can see my tenant is quite new, so I am not able to disable this setting anymore. You can see that it is enabled by default, but in older tenants, you have to enable this for either selected, so you can also use it for selected groups, or for all your users, and I recommend to do it for all your users. So when a user enrolls for Azure MFA, there are various knobs you can turn here. There are a lot of settings that can have effect on the user experience. First of all, you have to understand this screen. So imagine you're an administrator and you got one job. Go on and configure Azure MFA and enable MFA for all your users. So you would go to the Azure portal. Let me show you. You would go to the Azure portal Monday morning, and you're not sure where to look. You're gonna click around. You click on Azure Active Directory. You're gonna search here in the pane, and you see I have to do something with security. Next, you're finding this MFA button. You think that's the way to go because I need to enable MFA. But then you got this screen over here, and most of these settings here are not applicable to Azure MFA. They're only applicable to MFA Server, which is an on-premises MFA solution. So most of these settings, don't bother about them. It's only for MFA Server. The fraud alert is working for Azure MFA, and the auth tokens you can also use with Azure MFA, but all the other settings, you can just ignore them. You have to go to the additional cloud-based MFA settings, air quotes, additional, because this is the way to go to configure MFA settings. So it's a messy screenshot, but I think I make it clear, all of these settings are applicable to MFA Server and not to Azure MFA. So there are different ways that you can do a registration. You can do a manual registration by either going to one of these URLs that I provided in the slide deck. So aka.ms/mfa-setup was the old one, together with aka.ms/sspr-setup. Those were both for MFA and self-service password reset. And the new one is aka.ms/setup-security-info. And basically, they're all pointing towards my signins.microsoft.com or my account.microsoft.com. And then you can go on to security info to manually registration for MFA. For the best user experience, make sure that your user are registered for MFA before you enforce it. Otherwise, you can create loops, and it's already complex for a user. It can be really complex for some users. So you should do it in stages. So first of all, do a registration, and after that, enforce it for your end users. So there are a couple of ways that you can enforce the enrollment. Of course, one of the solutions here is to do per user MFA, because when you enable per user MFA, the next time the user signs in, he or she has to register for MFA. You could also create a conditional access policy like we showed earlier. We can create a conditional access policy, and after that, the next time that the user signs in, the registration is prompted. There are two other ways. The identity protection registration policy, which also has this 14 days grace period that we saw with security defaults. And now that I think about it, security defaults should also be in this list, because this will also trigger, like we discussed before, the MFA registration for all your users. And you can use self-service password reset policy. This will also require users to register for self-service password reset, obviously. And when you enabled the combined registration portal, it will also ask for your authentication method for Azure MFA. A quick tip. When you are looking to the sign-in logs in Azure Active Directory, you can see what method is triggering the second factor authentication. As you can see, there are multiple solutions here. You can either be triggered by conditional access or by per user MFA, or again, security defaults, and also specific apps that require MFA, but you can see it in the logs how your session was triggered for MFA. When you have both self-service password reset and MFA registration enforced, this diagram will teach you how many methods are required for either registration and for reset. So you should check this out. When you have both of these enabled, it can have effect on the end user experience, because basically there are two portals that have effect on the registration. The left one is what we showed earlier. That's the MFA settings. So when you select or deselect these verifications options, it will show in the registration for the end user. And also, since we are combining those two portals into one, the self-service password reset authentication methods will also be visible in the registration portal. Keep in mind, there is no setting to specify the order of the authentication methods. So some customers are asking, hey, can we enforce our users to first register for the phone, and after that, as a second backup method, they want to use authenticator app, for example. But Microsoft will always pick the most secure first, and then draw back to the least secure option. So Microsoft Authenticator app, when you enable it, will also be first in a row for the registration. I spent a lot of time, a good amount of time, to figure out all these settings and all the combinations that you can make, because you can make a lot of combinations with that, and it also affects the registration portal. So I strongly suggest that you check out this blog post that I wrote earlier, where I made some examples by selecting the different methods and then showing what the end result would be. And keep in mind, when you are going to play with this, with these settings, when you change settings in either one of the portals or service settings, it can take up to 50 minutes from my own experience. Maybe in the meantime, it's less, but it can take up quite some time before the settings are applied and when it's visible to the end user. So especially now everybody's working from home, By default, everybody can enroll for MFA and self-service password reset from any location and from any device. Well, it can be quite challenging to make that process more secure. You can also pre-provision some of the authentication methods for your users. We come to back to that later. But in this example, we assume that users would register themselves. And you can do it either by requiring a trusted device or a location. So you use conditional access for that, and you say, okay, when my users register for Azure MFA or self-service password reset, they need to be on a trusted device, which can be managed by Intune, or a trusted location. But especially the last one, trusted location, you have to go to a specific location to enroll for Azure MFA. This is not the way to go right now. You can also require multi-factor authentication. And I know that might sound a little bit weird, sound like a chicken and egg situation. We want to register for MFA, but also we need to do MFA first. So how does that work? Well, luckily we have the temporary access pass, the TAP. And good to know that the temporary access pass credentials satisfy the conditional access requirement for MFA. So what we can do is to create a temporary access pass and provide it to the user. And with that, they can enroll for MFA, and that you can configure that it can be only used once. So I prepared a little demo for that. Let's go back to the demo environment. And let's sign in to the portal. I'm going to use Adele for this particular demo. So here we see, because I enabled, like we saw earlier, I enabled conditional access for Adele. So Adele did not register for MFA. So the portal is asking for more information. So we click next. But again, we made a conditional access policy that will block this, because we required MFA before the user can register for MFA. So how does this work? Let me switch back. Let's go to conditional access. We created another policy. And instead of selecting a specific cloud application, we are going to choose for user actions. And here are two user actions that you can choose from at the moment, and one of them is register security information, and this will apply to the Azure MFA registration portal. Next, we're going to set a control, and we say, okay, before you can do that, you need to do multi-factor authentication. So basically, we're creating a chicken and egg situation. You cannot use, you have to use MFA before you can register for MFA. But luckily for us, we can use the temporary access pass. So let's go to the user section. Let's find Adele. And here under the authentication methods, we are going to create a temporary access pass for this user. So here you can configure the delayed start time. For purpose of the demo, we will let it be active right away, but we also say, okay, you can only use this one time. So when I create this, let's make another window. We have to go to this URL. If you go to the other URL, this won't work. So we go to aks.ms/mysecurityinfo. Oh, same session. Let's do it this way. Here we're going to sign in with Adele. And as you can see, now it's asking for the temporary access pass. Switch back to the portal. Here we can copy it and enter it. And if everything is good, Adele can now enable MFA with a secure security. So this would basically fix your, you can either sign in method here, authenticator app or phone in my case. So this is the way to do that. Let's go back to the portal again. So when we switch back, we can see that we configured that the temporary access pass was only allowed to use once. So if we switch back, we can now see that this is one-time use. So you cannot no longer use this temporary access pass, and you should go back to using your password instead. So on to the fun part. Azure MFA and Graph API. There are a couple of ways that you can manage these authentication methods. We saw earlier that we can encourage our users to register themselves, but in some situations, you want to provision this for your end users. So one of them that you saw earlier is using the Azure portal. Let's see. In the Azure portal, you can add authentication methods. For example, an email address for use to using self-service password reset, or a phone number and the temporary access pass that we saw earlier. But if you have to do this for every user manually, that would take a lot of work. So instead of that, we are make use of the Graph API. And this is a picture that I created to visualize what you can do with the Graph API authentication phone methods. So basically, you can either create, update, or delete different authentication methods, whether that's a mobile phone number or your office phone number or an alternate mobile phone number. And you can use the Graph API to either provision these authentication methods or to change them or to delete them. And I'm going to show you in a demo later how that works. So when you get started with Graph API, I encourage you to use the Graph Explorer. It will give you the ability to learn how this works. And there's a really easy to remember URL for that, aka.ms/GE, that stands for Graph Explorer, so that you can learn how to use Graph API together with Azure MFA. You also want to take a look at the API reference. So there are two reference documentations, either the version 1.0 or the beta, which will tell you common use cases to use this or provide you with sample queries. You don't have to make it all from scratch. It will provide some sample queries. You can use query parameters, or you have different request body and responses already lined out in the documentation that you can learn from. And most important, you have to know which permissions are required to ask for the specific information from the Graph API. There's also a JSON representation for how does it look. But before we go into that, you first need to know what can we provisioning user the Graph API and what we cannot provisioning. So FIDO2 keys we cannot provision because we have to create it manually on the device itself. Counts for Microsoft Authenticator app, you cannot provision Microsoft Authenticator app for your user. Your user has to do it by itself. Same counts for Windows Low for Business and either security questions, you cannot provision. The other three, the last three, temporary access pass, phone, and email, that one you can provision users using the Graph API. So let's switch back a couple of slides again. I want to point out, in this demo, I'm going to use the Graph API and Power Automate to do this, but you can also use PowerShell. I'm not that good in PowerShell, but there is an awesome blog from the identity man, Pim Jacobs, which will show you how you can pre-configure authentication methods using PowerShell, which also uses the Graph API, but you can build a script for that. So, to my slides. When you want to bulk provisioning, I've created this custom connector that you can use together with Power Automate to quickly enable MFA for your users using the Graph API. So how does that work? Here at the left, you provide a SharePoint file, or it can be on Excel or some other format, which holds the use principal name and the phone number that you want to enable for Azure MFA. Next, we're using Power Automate. together with the custom connector, I will show you in a minute how to install that, using the Graph API to input those phone numbers into Azure Active Directory, which the user then can use for multi-factor authentication. So I prepared a demo for that. For that, we have to switch to another tenant. So let's start off with the Graph Explorer. This is the Graph Explorer, and I got a couple of queries here in my notepad. Let's see what we can get from there. So basically, I'm picking the beta because it has more information, and I'm creating a get query. And what I'm doing here is I'm going to call the Graph API, and I'm going to ask for the authentication method of my test user, which is Lee, and I'm going to ask for the authentication phone methods that are currently enabled for this user. So when I run this query, it will spit out a response. Let me drag this a little so you can see it. Here you can see that there is an alternate mobile phone number with this number. There's also a mobile phone number with this number, and there is an office phone number, which we can see here. This represents exactly these phone numbers that we have provisioned here. So let me show you that I can delete one of these phone methods. So to do that, I specify one of the phone methods, which happens to be, let me see, what one did I pick? Alternate mobile. You can see this is the same ID that we're using here. And instead of get, I'm doing a delete. So basically now this number should be deleted. Fingers crossed. There we go. There isn't provided any feedback, but you can see that this is you get a result of 204, and that means that it is actually succeeded. So we can switch back to the Azure portal and do a quick refresh here. And now we can see, I don't know if you noticed, but the alternate mobile is now gone, and we only are left with two phone numbers. One of them is the mobile phone, and the other should be the office phone. Now, we can also use the Graph API to add that number back. And to do that, we are going to do a POST request. Again, for this user, and we're going to add a phone method. And for that, we need a JSON information. And this JSON information holds two things, the phone number and the phone type. In this case, the alternate mobile that we just deleted. So when we're doing this POST request, it will add back the phone number, and you can change the number here. Let's see if that runs. And again, it will provide some more information that the phone number is actually added. And as we switch back to the portal, we should see the phone number popping up again. Here's the number that we just provided. See the details. This is the alternate mobile that we just added. So this is a basic example of what you can do with the Graph API, using the Graph Explorer to add or delete or to just see what authentication methods there are for this specific user. Now, let's switch back to this example. So I showed you this example, and using the SharePoint, Power Automate, custom connector, there are quite a lot of things in place, but I will try to show you how I did this to get you started. So back to the portal. First of all, we're going to see in Power Automate custom connectors, the custom connector that I used. And this one you can easily import into your tenant using GitHub. You can see this is already enabled for my tenant, but you can add another one. We're going to add a new custom connector, and we're going to choose for import from GitHub. This one is in a public repository in the master branch. Here is Azure AD phone methods that you can use. So when you import this to Power Automate, it asks for a specific logo. You can upload an icon here. You can do something with the colors, but basically the important one is the security tab, which you have to provide with a client ID and a client secret that you have to create in Azure Active Directory, holding the Graph API permissions. In the third tab, you can see the definition. So here you can see There are a couple of actions within this custom connector. One of them is list the phone methods. The other one is creating for provisioning. There's also enabling SMS sign-in. If you want to use that, you can disable SMS sign-in, get the phone method specific for an ID, or delete one, or update in case you need to update the phone number. So when you got this in place, let's switch back to this Excel that I created. And basically what I did here is made a table with the username and the phone number for my users. So let's see. The first one, Vincent. Let's look him up real quick. Here's Vincent. Switch back to authentication methods. And as we can see, there are no authentication methods usable for Vincent. So there are no phone numbers or whatsoever. So now we're going to import this list into Power Automate and use this custom connector to provision the phone methods for these users. So I cancel this and I created a flow for that, create MFA methods. Let's quickly see how this is built up. It's pretty much easy. You can extend it, you can add logging, for example, but this is just for the purpose of this demo, it's really straightforward. I manually trigger this flow, so by kicking this off, then I'm going to list all the rows that are presented in the table, and I'm referring to this table over here, so it's pretty easy. And next, I say, okay, for each entry in this table, I want to grab this user principal name, and I want to create a phone number, and here I provide the phone number, which is here in the table. And I specify here what the phone type should be, which in this case should be mobile. So when I kick this off, again, fingers crossed. Let's run this. It can take a while, but I think if we switch back to the portal and we refresh, we can already see that the phone number for MFA is already provisioned with the number. And you can also see this in the audit logs. You can also see that I played around with it quite some time. But here you can see admin deleted phone methods and admin registered the phone methods. And you can also see what I use for it. So the Azure AD authentication method custom connector from the Power Platform. So this is basically how you pre-provisioning those phone numbers, which you then can use for Azure MFA, but also for self-service password reset. I keep this here for a reference. So if you want to get started with the Graph API, these are the queries that I just showed by getting all the authentication methods for my specific user and then deleting one and adding it back. So this should get you started if you want to try it out yourself. So last but not least, when you do an Azure MFA or self-service password reset enrollment, you can leverage reports queries in the Graph API. That you can use for Power BI reports. But there's also this report available in the Azure portal, which is recently renewed. It will show you how the registration goes for both Azure MFA and self-service password reset. And it also shows how many users are capable of passwordless authentication. And there is also a registration tab that you can use to see all the events. For example, if a user adds another phone number or deletes phone number or changes phone number or an administrator is changing the phone number, these events are also logged in the Azure portal. Next, to see what MFA methods your users currently have, you can use this script for Azure MFA. And it will get all the information about Azure MFA, the current setup, and it will provide you with the CSV file that holds the user principal name, whether they enrolled for MFA. You can also see the different methods that they enrolled, the count of the methods. So if a user has three methods enabled, you can see that back. And it is also giving you the recommendations. So if you have no Microsoft Azure authentication methods registered for your account, it will say, okay, you should probably jump to Microsoft Authenticator. So this will give you insights in how your users enrolled so far. And you can also use reports using the Graph API. There are a couple of examples out there in the reference, but remember, everything that you see in the Azure portal is just a GUI wrapped around this Graph API. So what you're seeing in the Azure portal is always available using the Graph API. So I showed a lot of stuff that I already wrote about, and I couldn't go into detail, but if you want to learn more, here are some references for some of my blog posts that you can read. And this will provide you with all the information that you saw in the earlier slides with a little more deep dive and a little more detail. So I encourage you to check this out. And with that, just in time, I want to thank you. And are there any questions? Because I have some time to answer the questions.
There were a couple of questions. Not sure if you have access to the chat yourself, but
yeah. Let me see. So there's a question. We went with the combined experience portal when it was in preview back in August last year because it was so much better and we had a big MFA rollout. Thankfully, we had no issues with it being in preview. Okay, that's good to know. It was in preview quite a while, but I encouraged my users, my clients to enable it, whether it was in preview or not, because it was so much better for the user experience. Jaap is asking, will Hello for Business sign-in also count for MFA in this purpose? On the top of my head, I would say yes, but I have to come back to that. I'm not sure. And there's also not a big fan of the activity view in Azure AD portal because it counts not only members, but also includes all guests with no filtering. Not sure what you mean by that, Steve. Do you mind coming off mute and tell me more about that?
Yeah, I am. No, just you were showing the activity report in the Azure AD portal where you can see how many users are eligible for MFA and how their methods are set.
This one.
Yeah, that one. If you have a big tenant with a lot of guests, the counter there will include all the guest accounts. And so it will say only 40% of your accounts are capable of Azure MFA, for example, because it just counts everything together.
Ah, I see. Well, in that case, you should you really start using the Graph API for this data because you can filter out the guests.
Yeah.
So this is just a representation of the Graph API. Like I said, it basically what you're seeing here is just data from the Graph API. But you can pull this data out and you can create your own Power BI dashboard, for example, filtering out all the guests.
Of course. Yeah, I'll just figure it's. I mean, for Microsoft, it can be very difficult just to put in a custom filter there. We can just switch members or guests.
Agree. Yeah, that would basically a filter for queries. So I don't know if they can do that, but I'm already happy with this because it shows a little bit. It gives a little bit insight without doing too much complex things. But I agree. This is not state of the art.
it's a V1. We'll get there with V4 or V5.
There's room for improvement.
Let's hope. Okay, I guess that's all the questions that I can see. Are there any more questions? No more questions? Oh, there's one more coming. You can come off mute if you want. Let's see, user has phone and configured his MFA. Phone is dead. We need to prepare a new one. Now we remove the user from the group which enables his conditional access MFA, prepare his phone, and when finished, we put him back in the group. Can we also use TemPass for that? Yes, temporary access pass is also for recovery purposes. There is a blog post on my site that explains what temporary access pass is. I believe it's still in preview, so it might change over time, but this is the way to go for recovery and onboarding purposes as well. Did that answer your question?
Dat helpt dus ook als je al on board is.
Yes.
Ja.
There's another question. I have a question about using SSPR and MFA in combined registration, in that the device you use for the authenticator app is often also the phone on which you receive text messages. That's true. So you can only reset a password with a telephone and then have both passwords and MFA. It cannot be enforced that the device must also be provided with an access code. What's your view on that? Interesting one. You can configure how many methods you should use. And from the top of my head, if you use two methods and you're also including Microsoft Authenticator app, you should also add a third one, because it's true what you say. The one with the Authenticator app is also, and most times, the phone that you use to receive text messages or phone calls. So that would be counting as one single method. So from what I've known, you should also add a third one when you're using Authenticator app. But I have to come back to that to be sure. But great question, Jaap.
Yeah, for resetting, you only need two. So you have to register three methods, but the user can choose which methods to use to reset the password.
I'm not sure how to fix that. I have to come back to that, Jaap. So okay. if you can ping me offline, then we can figure this out. Must be a solution for that.
Okay. I'll do.
Thanks.
But you can configure as admin which methods can be used. So you might want to enable text messages then, or phone call.
Yeah, but I think what Jaap tries to say is that they only register two, and then they cannot pick a third one when they try to reset their passwords.
Oh, not true. Yeah.
But we figure it out. Any more questions? Good luck with that. The users, they should start a pay raise, and if they can have that, they should also be able to have a P1 license. It gives them so much more. But I know the struggle is real. P1, P2 licenses. Good luck with that. Okay, I think that's it. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, Jan. It was a very nice session, very informative, and I think you covered it all. So thanks again for joining us. And to all the attendees, next webinar is on June the 8th with Thorsten and Michael. And thanks, of course, to our sponsors again. And hope to see you next time.
Bye.
Bye.